And today we're going to be talking about sex.
Yeah.
This is my two great friends, Mary Lou and Lydia, who you've seen on the channel before.
Hey.
And hi. They are both my resident sexologists.
Okay, hi. My name is Dr. Mary Lou, and I'm based out of Southern California. I'm also a little person, and I like to talk about sex.
My name is Lydia Andrade Zuniga. I'm from the San Francisco Bay Area, and I'm part of an organization called Sexability. Our website is www.sexability.org. We primarily empower and advocate for and provide resources for individuals with disabilities that are seeking sexual expression and sexual freedom and just access to sex in general.
Yes, if you'd like to reach me, my website is drmarylou.com, drmarylou.com.
And I'll put their links in the description below so you can check out more information and anything we might talk about here in this video. So ladies, this is what I was thinking, is that often sex is seen as a physical act, but many people with disabilities have physical challenges. So what do you think about sex as more of a cerebral act? How do you advocate, educate that people with disabilities can and should and have a right to a full and healthy and fulfilling sexual experience and life?
So, what often happens is true, that we have a lifetime of medical issues, or if you acquire a disability, all of a sudden you're thrown into a medical model of lifestyle, and then sexuality is put on the back burner. And so there's an asexual attitude, even from the medical industry, that you're not a sexual being, and therefore you don't have desires. But we all know that we all have desires. And the issue is the expression of sexuality. How can we express ourselves in a way that's safe and non-judgmental, so that we're validated, we're heard, and we're loved? Because at the end of the day, we all want to feel connected. We want to feel and hear that someone can say, "I hear you, I validate you, I love you."
And what about for you, Lydia? From being able-bodied before your accident to being disabled, and how did that change your life? How did you change your sex life?
Well, because we're so driven by societal pressures on what is sexy, what sex should look like, what sex is, it's very, very hard to transition from having a life of being completely able in a physical aspect to having to be more creative. So in that sense, you have to really tap into a larger perspective of what access is and looks like, and what sex is and looks like to you.
Yeah, well, I was going to say that even though I have come across professionals who are well-meaning and want to work with people with disabilities, there's often a gap as to what it is that those needs are. As far as people with disabilities, sometimes they don't even know what those needs are, and there's a lot of shame and embarrassment to ask for help or even ideas. And I see a lot of people who really want to know more, and they're afraid to ask because they don't want to look like they're inadequate in some way. But in the general population, everybody wants to have a more satisfying sex life. So it doesn't matter if you're disabled or not. Everybody wants to enhance that aspect of themselves. And a little bit of education, a little bit of coaching, tweaking some techniques and adaptive position, it can be very fulfilling. It's so important to understand what your body is about, what you like and what you don't like, before you can share that with a partner. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't take the time to do that, and they expect someone else to figure it out, and that's not fair. And in the workshop that we do, either the workshop we do together or separately, it's all about creating better communication skills.
Yes.
To ask for what you need, ask what you need of your partner, and how to figure out to bridge the gap. That's one of my mottos, is bridging the gap between your limitations to fulfilling your sexual desires. There's always a way. The other thing I wanted to say is, what exactly is pleasure? Pleasure means different things to different people.
Yep, amen.
And a lot of people think that intercourse is the objective. And it's not. It could be just cuddling or touching a certain way, making time to take a bubble bath, making time to lay down together and listen to music.
Right.
Maybe developing some tantra skills where you can be doing some eye gazing. all of these things can be exciting and wonderful, and it doesn't even have to lead towards an orgasm because it is a mental, emotional construct.
Sex is an important part of our life. It doesn't need to be something to be ashamed of. It should, you know, in my opinion, it should be something that you are seen as a whole person, and you should feel safe to talk about it with your clinicians. You know, when you go to the doctor's office, again, back to the whole thing, many people with disabilities are seen as asexual. You know, they're not going to raise it with you. They're probably not going to. Maybe some will, but some won't. And so it's like, you know, why I want to do this topic today and just to start a conversation. And I really encourage you guys to, if you have questions, more comments, please through me, or I'll put their socials in the description below and you can reach out to them directly. You guys will be more than willing to you know, help answer questions.
Yeah, it'd be great to hear from you. For,
yes.
Awesome. Okay, well, this is a wrap, guys. Thank you. Have a good one.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.